He never gives up. He's Alex Jones, broadcasting from deep in the heart of Texas, worldwide.
You do. Pelosi can hardly talk. Maxine Waters can hardly talk. Chucky Schumer can hardly talk. They look real scared, don't they? Because they know who they've been representing. They were presiding over an asleep population, and they thought they were in the land of milk and honey. They thought it would never end. But all over the world, their programs are in deep crisis. Milo's got the number one book on Amazon and going up the New York Times charts a month before it comes out. Promised he'd give us a big Skype interview. I think he's going to be joining us. He wants me to go out to Miami next week and do some big celebration broadcast. I'm tempted to do it because the Joe Rogan thing went so well. We immediately saw like 15 million new listeners come into the streams and the views. I was like, man, that's great. I go on Fox News. We don't get like 10,000 new people. I can go on Fox News. I don't even see a blip on our traffic. Because they got an audience, but it's a bunch of zombies on average. I'm not saying you're a zombie if you watch, but you know what I mean. The average person's not really doing much that watches that. I go on some little Christian station. We just blows our doors off, you know, going for an hour. Go on Coast to Coast AM, get a big response. Go on Howard Stern, get a big response. But mainstream media, not so much. Speaking of mainstream media, let's go to some of the clips of the Barack Obama's tough talk on immigration tied into old 45. Here it is.
All Americans, not only in the states most heavily affected, but in every place in this country, are rightly disturbed by the large numbers of illegal aliens entering our country. The jobs they hold might otherwise be held by citizens or legal immigrants. The public service they use impose burdens on our taxpayers. That's why our administration has moved aggressively to secure our borders more by hiring a record number of new border guards, by deporting twice as many criminal aliens as ever before, by cracking down on illegal hiring, by barring welfare benefits to illegal aliens. In the budget I will present to you, we will try to do more to speed the deportation of illegal aliens who are arrested for crimes, to better identify illegal aliens in the workplace, as recommended by the commission headed by former Congresswoman Barbara Jordan. We are a nation of immigrants, but we are also a nation of laws.
Even as we are a nation of immigrants, we're also a nation of laws. Undocumented workers broke our immigration laws, and I believe that they must be held accountable, especially those who may be dangerous. When I took office, I committed to fixing this broken immigration system. And I began by doing what I could to secure our borders. But today, our immigration system is broken. And everybody knows it. There are actions I have the legal authority to take as president. Tonight, I'm announcing those actions. We'll build on our progress at the border with additional resources for our law enforcement personnel so that they can stem the flow of illegal crossings and speed the return of those who do cross over. If you're a criminal, you'll be deported. If you plan to enter the U.S. illegally, your chances of getting caught and sent back just went up. We expect people who live in this country to play by the rules. We expect that those who cut the line will not be unfairly rewarded. The actions I'm taking are not only lawful, they're the kinds of actions taken by every single Republican president and every single Democratic president for the past half century. And to those members of Congress who question my authority to make our immigration system work better, question my authority, question my authority, question my authority, question my authority, or question the wisdom of me acting where Congress has failed, I have one answer. Pass a bill.
Well, Milo, a very busy man, probably the biggest news story other than President Trump the last week since leftists viciously attacked him and others at UC Berkeley, beating up women, you name it. And since Robert Reich and others who work at the school came out and said it was a good thing, basically, Milo's book has gone to number one across the charts. And they've now got a video game out. It's up on InfoWars.com. It's on Drudge. It's on Breitbart.com, where they're saying, kill him. Beat him to death. And we also got the secret plans. Dr. Corsi got them. This story really needs to go viral. Leaked docs. Brock conspires with Facebook, Google, to shut down conservative news. I don't really call myself conservative. I'm just common sense, Americana, libertarian. But yeah, they want to shut down libertarians, conservatives, you name it. Anybody that's gay like Milo who doesn't, you know, agree with whatever the latest brainwashing is, or if he agrees with free speech, he's got to be shut down. We have Der Spiegel here with us as well today, there in the Peanut Gallery. And of course, they claim Trump's trying to chop the heads off of liberty by doing something four presidents have done, and it's the law. Meanwhile, they don't show you in Der Spiegel the jihadis cutting heads off because Merkel is in a deal with Peter Sutherland of the UN to get rid of the homogeneity of Europe. So, look, I'm not just saying everything should be white, but God, I hear I need to be dealt with and gotten rid of. It's crazy. So Milo joins us with the balance of the hour. In fact, we're looking at maybe going out to Florida next week for a special celebration transmission here live on air. We'll know about that by tomorrow. But Milo, where to begin? I mean, it just seems like things are getting crazier and crazier. I'm a little jealous that there's not a big video game where I get beaten and killed, though. So I'm not doing my job here. I'm getting a little jealous.
No, I thought if there was going to be a video game of one or the other of us, it would be you first. I thought you would be the one to get the Let's Punch Alex Jones video game. I'm sorry that didn't happen. Maybe I'll make you one.
Well, where to start since we just talked on Monday? I mean, it just seems like they're going crazier and crazier and crazier. What's the latest?
Well, it's now just sort of outright open season on anyone with politics to the right of Jane Fonda. You know, you can call them Nazis, you can call us white supremacists, anti-Semites, pretty much anything you can think of, you know, from anyone from your sort of libertarian Americana politics, as I think is a good summary of you and many of your listeners. You know, I'm a sort of, I don't even know what I am, to Breitbart, you know.
No, but that's good. Define yourself. I mean, because it's hard to define a complex person. I mean, but how would you define yourself?
Well, I suppose I'm a cultural libertarian. I think people should be able to say, do, and be anything. Economically, I'm probably conservative. Foreign policy, probably, I don't know, sort of nationalist protectionist. That's where I kind of come up and touch Trump supporters, I guess.
Sure.
Strong borders, not a huge
fan. But you're a free speech guy now. I mean, you're Mr. Free Speech.
That is what I'm most known for, and that's the cultural libertarian sort of bit of it. I want people to just be able to read anything, play anything, do anything.
Why do they? That's a great definition of yourself. Why do they? I mean, obviously, you're a good-looking guy. You're sharp. You're well-spoken. They're everything they wish they were. Let's just be honest. Is that why they're so pissed at you?
Well, you know, Ann Coulter said this on Twitter, and she got so much criticism from it. She's absolutely right. Where would protests be without fat girls? And you know, it's not a nice thing to say. But you look out there at the Women's March, you look at all this kind of stuff, and you've got very miserable, older, single, lonely millennials looking for someone to blame. They're looking for a reason their life
is. By the way, you've been saying that for years. When I was in the Women's March in D.C., I'm not being mean because I'm not, you know, I'm 40-something years old, not as good looking as I used to be. I'm not putting down women that are overweight, but it was like crazy, aggressive, ugly, giant, fat women screaming and yelling the name of their vagina and then telling me I'm an effing white male, go to hell. It was like, this is some kind of joke.
I know. And of course, Rush said this many years ago, you know, feminism is how unattractive women get into the mainstream, you know, get attention. And guess what? So it seems to me the opposition to Trump falls into that category. What we've done in culture is provide women with a battery of conflicting lies that they are expected at some point over their life to try to reconcile. We've told them they can have everything, but also in the workplace they're victims, which is not true. You know, campus rape culture and the wage gap, all of that is garbage. We've told them that, you know, variety of things that simply don't conform to reality, with the result that we've created a generation of really unhappy women. And those women are looking for somebody to blame. They're looking to lash out. And Trump has, I think, been a locus for, and so am I, actually. And part of the reason I am is that, you know, I'm gay, so I don't have to be nice to women because I don't want to have sex. So, you know, I don't have to pretend to be nice to girls. So I'll talk about, you know, the vast gap, you know, between feminism and reality, between, you know, campus conspiracy theories and how people are actually suffering in America. In many, very, very many cases, it's the men suffering, not the women. And because I don't have skin in the game, you know, I can be honest about it. So they hate me just as much. But the key thing for me, really, and what this book is about, and what Berkeley was about, is the fact that the left today has become so fundamentally terrified of differing opinions, absolutely petrified of free speech, because for 30 years they have run academia, they've run the entertainment industry, they've run the news business, they've run all of these big institutions of civil, social,
and they've run it all into the ground.
And they've run it badly. They've run it really badly. And they've got so complacent over those 30 years that they've started to make two really big strategic errors, as I see it. One is they just insult everyone they don't like instead of reasoning with them, instead of arguing with them. And that's the sort of shut up straight white male instinct, you know?
Yeah, they'll never debate. They're in public in front of cameras but won't talk to us.
No, because they don't know the facts, because they got so used to just having their opinion waved through, they've forgotten how to defend it. And they've also not realized that times have moved on. And 30 years ago, many of the things that feminists were saying might have been true, but they're not anymore. You know, more women now go to college, more women graduate, they get better grades. That wasn't the case 30 years ago.
Well, and I'm going to go back into this, but shifting gears to the tragic nightclub shooting that killed, 50-something people, they tried to cover up Islamic terror there, and, you know, Trump pointing out Islamic terror now and the fact that they've whitewashed it. But for everybody I've talked to across the country, it was a major turning point in the gay community, going out, getting firearms, you talking about that, saying, hey, I shoot back. I mean, growing up at parties, college, whatever, it wasn't whether somebody was black or white or gay or straight. It was whether were they fun to hang out with? Did they tell good jokes? So I grew up not being guilty about hating anybody. And now I've been attacked and told I'm this hate monger. It's really kind of pissed me off. But it seems like that nightclub massacre was a key turning point. Am I right to say that?
I think it was a wake up call. I think it was the moment people realized that identity politics had gone nuts. Because, you know, you had a Muslim guy shooting as a result of his ideology, as he told us, he was very clear about that, killing 49 gays and hurting another 50. And the response of the progressive left was, oh, we must be careful about Islamophobia in the wake of Orlando.
And wasn't it that he was also, like, really latent and he was upset about what he was doing? Because he had the gay app and was, you know, cruising, right?
Yeah, I did read reports about that. I don't know if it was true. I don't know because two of the witnesses who said they'd had sex with him turned out to be in various different ways.
Sure, but regardless, they tried to make it all about the poor Muslims.
Yes, of course they did. And this was the first time that we realized that logic, reason, and fact had gone out of the window, and that you couldn't trust any more journalists, celebrities, politicians, or really anybody in public life, anybody in polite society, to tell the truth when bad things happen between conflicting groups who don't like each other very much. It is only a surprise to journalists.
Sure. Let me ask you this question. France has been over to the Islamic invasion, the very nastiest of the nasty. So they attack there, they murder there, they hate it, they have contempt. The liberals and the gays have just rolled out a red carpet on average to Islam, but all over the world they attack gay nightclubs. I mean, where's the 2+2=4 here?
It's completely insane. And this is what happens when you start to focus. And you were saying a moment ago, you know, when you were at college, and this is the same for me. I mean, you know, we're not too far away in age. And when we were growing up, you know, we were living in the legacy of Martin Luther King. You know, it was about the contents of your character, not the color of your skin. Well, we've thrown out logic, reason. In fact, we've thrown out character, we've thrown out learning, we've thrown out, looking into somebody's heart, and instead inherited this system of politics that judges people, categorizes them, and gives them various special treatment and privileges according to their skin color, their sexuality, and their gender. That is the worldview that the majority of American media buy into, that almost the entire American higher education establishment buys into, and that a sizable proportion even of politicians buy into. And it is poisonous, it is counterfactual, and it is ludicrous. And it gives rise to these absurdities like having to defend Islamic terrorists or at least pander to Islam in the wake of 50 gay people being shot in Florida, of all places. It's so, so awful. And because it's so completely unsustainable, it requires a strategy of clamping down on free speech in order to survive. Because you cannot make social justice arguments in good conscience with possession of
all
the facts.
That's exactly it. It's common sense. So, Milo, let me ask you this. And I don't say this to be chilling. I mean, this is what my gut tells me. And so I don't say this to be, you know, like some type of bad omen or whatever. But I personally have family. I personally get threats. So I kind of limit my public stuff. Not that I'm afraid and I don't want to give in to them. But at the same time, it's kind of like, hey, I got kids. I get you don't. But the name of your book's Dangerous. You're one of the most popular icons out there. You're only going up because, again, you deserve it. You're a smart guy. You've got courage. Fortune favors the brave. The future goes to those that are bold. And you've definitely taken that flood of fortune. So you're having a huge event. You're having a huge effect. My concern is, and I'm glad you're going back to Berkeley. I know you've got, you know, Navy SEAL protection, all the rest of it. But at the same time, these people really hate you because you're really hurting them. And so I just want to ask you, you know, you're doing these events a couple times a week. They're trying to kill you, basically. Do you ever just think maybe you're tempting fate? And again, I admire what you're doing. I just am kind of in the same boat. So I think I want to come out to Berkeley with Milo and share in the First Amendment, share in all the attention, too, to wake folks up. But at the same time, I go, man, you know, God, these are really dangerous scum. Should I even put myself in the middle of their nest?
Well, I don't blame you. You have a family and you have children to look after. Going up against the modern progressive left with its heavily organized, well-funded anarchist shock troops, as they showed up at the inauguration and as now show up to my talks, they show up to three of them.
Yeah, because they're saying kill you. I mean, yeah.
Well, they say kill Trump, they say kill Milo, they say all sorts of things. And they also just, I mean, you know, look, you don't need, this isn't just about property. I mean, the reports came out that $100,000 worth of Berkeley College property and $500,000 worth of property in downtown Berkeley were destroyed. But that, for me, was not really the big deal. I mean, all that stuff's insured.
No, it's women being beaten and then the university defending it.
And pepper sprayed. And the university's response, by the way, Berkeley's response was to deploy Robert Reich, who was a Clinton staffer, to CNN to say that, Breitbart did it. They employed these people themselves to come and to beat up their own audiences. And just the most incredible, I mean, look at you, you've got the pictures for your viewers there. The most incredible, outrageous thing. Newsweek published him saying it. The University of Berkeley republished the Newsweek piece on their own website and then tweeted it. You know, this is the University of Berkeley basically accusing me and Breitbart of hiring 150 thugs to beat up our own audience.
Meanwhile, we have the WikiLeaks of Soros doubling down the number of people he's funding. So let me ask you this. You're a smart guy. I mean, I'm not being condescending. You are. What does your gut tell you where this is going? Because they're losing power. Everything's blowing up in their face. They're now having fight club training to beat up anybody that's libertarian or conservative. I mean, this is the most fascist behavior you can imagine. They call us fascists. Where in your gut does it tell you this is leading?
They want to burn my book while calling us the fascists. It's funny. They don't see the irony. I think that it's going to get worse before it gets better. We all just have to stay safe and make sure that we are taking adequate precautions. It does, by the way, make our lives extremely complicated, very expensive, and very cumbersome. But, of course, being libertarians and Republicans, we have real jobs and we can afford it. So thank
God. And by the way, Milo, we're not being drama queens. I don't even want to bring this up on air. I have to have security now. And I mean, like, you know, the real deal, former Blackwater, you name it. Because I'll be at a place eating dinner and a leftist will walk over with a gun in their hand. I mean, they're so pissed and they really think I'm Hitler, even though I've never said anything racist and love everybody. They are. It's a damn cult. I don't know what to do about these people.
Well, I think it's going to get worse before it gets better. I think, and I have to say, I'm sorry to say this, is just to double down on your chilling prophecy. I do think that something is going to happen to someone. And I do think there's going to be a high-profile incident. And when that happens, I think the president will have no choice but to deploy the National Guard, you know, to protect certain speakers, you know, for the crime of being Republicans or the crime of being libertarians or the crime, really, of being anything other than social justice warriors. Because college campuses won't, you know, college campuses don't even like feminists anymore. You know, you've got Jermaine Greer, one of the icons of the feminist movement, cast out from social justice for not having the right opinion about transgender people. It's really anybody who doesn't sign up to the whole catalog of crazy. These people are going to have to be protected. And
that's key. You've got to sign up to the whole catalog and whatever the latest update like software is. There's like new weekly updates with like 100 different genders. And if I don't know them all, I'm a hateful person.
It's so true. It's like, you know, antivirus software. It's always bugging you to update it. It's like, oh, there's a new pack of virus definitions, like every 4 hours. And if you don't do it, the software like disables itself or something. That's social justice. And if you don't have your computer on and click the button every 5 minutes, you're not.
How about people just be loving and do whatever they want and then we have a free society?
Well, that is the reason the First Amendment exists, to try and create just such a society. Unfortunately, I think it's going to, as I say, have to get worse before it gets better. I also think these Antifa, these black bloc types, I mean, there's a report came out, the Daily Caller and Breitbart covered this as well. It was very clear that George Soros had given $50 million to one of the organizations that was involved in protest against me. So this is in part a Soros thing, but I think these people, these highly organized, well-funded people, and there are, you know, a small number of them, and they travel around, they go to all of these things. You know, 150 of them showed up in Berkeley. These people need to be categorized as what they are, domestic terrorists.
No, they are. They're trying to shut down our free speech and politically intimidate us. But they're trying to start a fight with 100 million gun owners and the police and military that are awake. I mean, they really are delusional. What do you think Soros is thinking? I mean, does Soros have a crush on you? Is that why he spent $50 million? Because that's been leaked. That's public. I mean, $50 million to target Milo.
I mean, I'm flattered, of course. You know, I've had ex-boyfriends who have done things almost as bonkers. But, you know, I think it's just about sowing panic and chaos and fear. They've realized that they can't get to Trump anymore because now he's the president. He has the apparatus of the state protecting him. So it's very difficult for them to physically endanger Donald Trump. What they can do, which they did at the inauguration, was physically endanger his supporters. And what they can do is physically endanger me.
That's right. So they can target Trump's proxies.
Right. Or, you know, people who like him or people who are spreading words of like mischief, dissidents, freedom, whatever it is, you know, people, they really don't like, and this is what all authoritarians hate, is the sound of laughter. They don't like, you know, people having fun while disagreeing.
I agree. They're obsessed with not letting us meet or have our own culture. That's why you want to tell people your idea we should do, where you have like a big party on TV and just, you know, hang out at the beach, make a big joke out of them.
I think we should. I very much love for you to come over. I'm in my little hideaway in South Florida at the moment. I think we should go to Miami Beach. I think we should get a big big suite on the beach, have cocktails, and have a little Trump party and not live streaming.
No, they'll certainly hate that because you're right. They do hate fun. I mean, because these aren't the liberals I knew. Growing up, I liked the liberals I knew that were anti-war and they were cool and they were smart and they knew about the universe. Those old liberals I know hate the Democrats now and are secret Trump supporters, because the truth is I think Trump's the real liberal. He wants to give us more of our money, more of our freedom. He's never done anything. He was against the Iraq war.
He's also an existential threat to political correctness. You know, he's the one person that, you know, I think maybe Trump and I are the two people in America who have done the most damage to identity politics. Him through,
I agree, because he makes a joke out of it.
Right. He just doesn't give a hoot, you know. He'll just bulldoze through. And I am kind of like this massive, like, living, breathing, screaming mascot about how, you know, you could be gay and you don't have to sign up to, you know, giving 70% of your money away to the federal government or anything else. A sexuality has nothing to do with your political opinion.
Sure, you're not letting him speak for you. You're pointing it out to other people who don't want them to speak for them.
Right. And, you know, that shouldn't be a revelation in a country with the First Amendment, that people with a particular sexuality, skin color, or gender don't have to all believe the same stuff. It shouldn't be a revelation.
Again, that's called a cult. Wouldn't you call what the Democrats have become and liberals worldwide? Like you said, it's a cult.
It certainly exhibits some cultic behaviors. I would absolutely agree in terms of the ritualistic kind of behavior on Twitter, in terms of how they treat apostates, you know, how they treat people who no longer want to be part of the club.
Heretics.
Yeah, exactly. These are the behaviors of a cult. And
let me raise this, and then when we come back, I'm going to bring in another host to ask you a few questions, and I appreciate you giving us so much time. I know you're really busy. Congratulations on your book being number one. And I have seen the articles where they want to burn your book once it's in bookstores. You couldn't ask for something better. I mean, again, let me ask you that then. Do they know how stupid they look, Milo?
No, I don't think so. I mean, other people have tried in the past. There's a guy called Ryan Holiday, who's an Observer columnist, who has very successfully trolled people on the left before, like Gawker and whatever.
By the way, people couldn't see because we put up your butt, but you were like just reveling in the fact they're trying to censor you.
Well, of course, because, you know, look, here's a crucial thing, okay? As New York Magazine admitted last week, and as I said on Tucker Carlson on Fox last week, I don't hold any particularly controversial opinions. I say them in controversial ways. I make jokes about people you're not supposed to make jokes about, and I like to.
Well, that's the most protected speech.
Of course it is. I like to. I'm a comedian. I like to provoke, and I like to make people laugh and make people think. But I don't have any opinions that millions of ordinary Americans don't share. I just convey them in a more persuasive and funny way and on a bigger platform. And that's why they find me dangerous, because I'm persuading people. I'm winning people.
Well, sure. And like you said, you're speaking what everybody else already thinks and making people realize they're not alone. That's your real crime.
Right. And when people read this book, and they'll read it because of all of the drama and controversy and censorship, they will discover actually a very reasonable, agreeable set of principles that everybody can get behind. You know, free speech, expression.
Well, I mean, as a gay man, then, what did you think of Trump waving a rainbow flag, telling Republicans we need to be nice to everybody and be inclusive, and everybody cheering? I was there at the RNC. So were you. That was, the Democrats couldn't bring people together. It'd all be about division. It was incredible unity. And then they claim he's a homophobe. It's just not true.
But just on the facts, you know, I like to put aside feelings and rhetoric and look at the facts. On the facts, Trump is the most pro-gay candidate in presidential history, and I think he's already the most pro-gay president. I mean, this is a guy who, in, you know, the RNC, this has never happened before. He put Peter Thiel on stage to say he was proud of being gay and proud of being a Republican. Great moment. And Trump, you know, did the same thing with a little troll, of course, because it's Trump. You know, it was an LGBTQ, and you know he has no idea what that means. But one of, you know, maybe, I don't know, maybe Steve or something thought it would be funny to put in the speech just to wind up the left, and it was funny. You know, because that's how they talk, but not how we talk. But, you know, it was funny. But you know, he came straight in and he said he's not going to do anything about gay marriage. He's not going to change, you know, protections for gay people, for federal employees, all the rest of it. You know, Hillary Clinton on
the other hand. This is a hard break. Stay there. We're going to come back and finish up with that, because regardless of what you think of the issue, the media is lying about what Donald Trump's done. He's unifying America around prosperity and freedom. And it's a good thing, and bringing God back into it and including everybody. That's why they're so scared. He is the great unifier. Stay with us. Well, Milo's our guest. He really doesn't need any introduction. I'm going to plug something here real quick. We're listener supported. We're supported by products we sell. And Roger Stone's new book, I'm trying to get an order in for Milo's book as soon as it comes out in hardcover at InfoWarsStore.com. We have The Making of a President 2016. 20% off. No need to discount it. We're just doing it to dominate Amazon.com. And every book is signed. The first 10,000, I'm signing as well. Takes a lot of money to fund this operation. Plus, we have Super Blue non-fluoride toothpaste with iodine and nano silver plus peppermint and tea tree oil. This is made at the biggest organic toothpaste producer in the country's system. And then we just have our ingredients added into it as well. We have bubblegum flavor coming in about a month for children who don't like the super strong peppermint and tea tree oil. But if you want really strong, natural, amazing system with nano silver, iodine, peppermint oil, xylitol, a groundbreaking fluoride-free formula, be sure and get it at InfoWarsStore.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. A lot of other nutraceuticals are also for sale on the site. We did sell out of Super Blue, which is great because that helps fund our operation, but people are really looking for this, I guess. And we ordered almost triple the amount. When the bubblegum flavor comes in, it'll be triple because we got a limited amount of that. I don't blame kids. I mean, this is strong toothpaste. But this is how we fund our operation. It's $9.95. It's a big old tube of it, and I appreciate all your support. We have our methylcobalamin vitamin B12 organic taken out of the tongue. It's the best thing, you know, after injections, and it's available at InfoWarsStore.com as well, 10% off. Right now, we have the limited edition. It is ending next week. I've got to end it. Trump is my president red shirt, which we put out before he was president, kind of a portend, an omen. And so much more. Hillary for President 2017, deport George Soros, nanotech body armor, only civilian sellers of this because we've got a lot of friends in the Defense Department. Oh, yeah, even the CIA called up wanting this. I'm not kidding. You can't make that up. That's how cutting-edge InfoWars is. They're like, does it really stop all these rounds? Yeah, man, that's why it's got 5.0 reviews. I mean, you know, look at the guys we got testing in. I mean, you think Q ever did anything for the CIA? You think Easter bunnies hop around on Easter? Anyways, ladies and gentlemen, we have it all. InfoWarsStore.com or 888-253-3139. And we pledge to you, as you fund us, we will only become more aggressive in the fight for human liberty. Now, speaking of more aggressive, Milo is our guest. Everybody knows who Milo is. We've been talking so much about this. Kevin Martin, who I hope to get as one of our reporters, great activist on the street as well, exposing tyranny. Pop in anytime you want, Kevin, kevinmartin.info. Milo, before we go any further here in the time we have, what else is going on in Milo world? What? Give us sneak peeks of what else is going on, websites, events, what your crystal ball tells you is coming in the future.
Thank you. It's always so confusing. There's so much going on. So I have a very, very big speech that I'm not allowed to tell you yet, but I can tell you about 24 hours. So keep an eye on Breitbart. It's going to be Breitbart.com/Milo. Keep an eye on my Facebook as well. A very, very big speech at the end of this month, which is going to be kind of like the – it's going to be what Berkeley should have been before it was canceled by leftist thugs. It's going to be in Washington, D.C. It's going to be a very, very big speech at a very, very big event. And you'll be able to tune into that live, and it'll be very heavily covered. It's going to be a very, very important moment. The week after that, I think we're going to go back to Berkeley. My book comes out a little bit after that. I'm also going to be doing a commercial tour this year. So if you're not a student and you weren't able to see me on campus and you want to come and see me in a more traditional venue, I'll be doing a tour later in this year as well.
Well, let's talk about censorship, and then pop in any time, Kevin. Milo, listen, the media distorted what I said on Pizzagate. I never targeted some pizza place. The media focused on that. The internet did that. I covered what was in the WikiLeaks, all sorts of weird spirit cooking and Aleister Crowley stuff. As long as it's not illegal, whatever, that's their issue. They can legally do that. But there was a lot of other weird stuff, and now there's all these big roundups of perverts going on, all these things happening. And then I was on Joe Rogan's Experience, and it had more views than anybody's ever had, broke all records, but Google Plays blocked it. We also had some of the other channels block it. And they're really trying to censor it. And Joe's calling me during the breaks going, do you know what's going on? I don't even know what's going on because in this whole fake news cycle, they will make up something we've said. I mean, Megyn Kelly, I'm not attacking Megyn Kelly, but she took an edited tape. I talked about Hillary supporting Islamicists raping kids and said that I meant that was about some pizza place. I know nothing about that. What is your view overall on that, or just on how they say we're fake news? And this whole David Brock move to take an agency Trump didn't fund, but Obama did, and try to launch this censorship, because you were banned off Twitter when we were at the RNC with you. I mean, you are like the epicenter of this. I wish I was. Sometimes I wish I wasn't. But, I mean, really, we've experienced where they make up what you've said, or you make fun of Ghostbusters, which was a flop, and they ban you because you make fun of a Sony Pictures. I mean, this is dangerous.
Yeah, I mean, so yeah, you're right. I'm kind of patient zero with some of this stuff. You know, I wrote a bad review of Ghostbusters, didn't like it, and that was Twitter's excuse to pounce because, oh, I've criticized a black woman, which apparently is, you know, the highest imaginable crime in America these days. Look, it was very dumb for the progressive mainstream media to go on this fake news crusade, because they are more responsible than anybody else for lying to and lying about the American people, and they know it. They were wrong about absolutely everything throughout the entire presidential run. They were wrong about everything to do with Trump. They were sharing polls. They were manipulating polls. They were outright manipulating polls, like, you know, with sample bias and stuff like this. And yet they choose to go on a fake news crusade in an effort to damage places like Breitbart, which were very, you know, powerful, very helpful things to Trump, of course, because, you know, our readers like him as you know, a lot, and we were covering these issues they care about. So they tried to sort of, in revenge, if you like, damage the people and outlets that they thought might have helped Trump get in. Well, with the inevitable result that they have
been stung.
Well, they've been, yes, but they've also been stung more by this than anybody else. You know, when you've got Trump saying, I'm not taking a question from CNN, you're fake news. You know, CNN is now the subject of like...
Because they really are the fake news. I mean, I sit here every day. I cover real stuff that's going on. I'm not making jack crap up. There's so much real stuff, I can't even cover half of it. Why would I make something up and discredit myself?
But you've been on the receiving end of this too. I mean, you know, they just make things up. So Berkeley, for instance, you know, they're trying to justify the violent response.
They said with no evidence, which is totally defamation, that you funded that group of goons that had tried to kill you and others and were beating women half to death. I mean, when they're openly on the leftist website saying, go kill Milo.
Right, and this is CNN and Newsweek. This is Robert Reich, who was a Clinton staffer. He was in the Clinton cabinet, and now he's a professor at Berkeley. And then they made up that I was planning, because I was gonna launch an initiative with David Horowitz, you know, about sanctuary campuses. You know, the students who come over here who are not really supposed to be in the country, and we were supposed to launch an initiative. They completely made up, just out of nowhere, that I was planning at Berkeley to start putting the names and photos of illegal students at Berkeley up on the projector during my talk. Never planned, was never going to happen. I wouldn't mind doing it, but I just wasn't going to. You know, as it happens, I had no plan of doing that. It's not a terrible idea. Maybe I should have done it, but I wasn't planning to do it. And I told them I wasn't planning to do it, and they ran the stories anyway. They just make things up.
Kevin Martin, you're sitting here. You know, you've done some viral videos out there. In fact, we should probably queue up one of the ones where he comes up to the lady saying, you know, whites are basically evil, and you're like exposing that Black Lives Matter is like a KKK group. I mean, here you are witnessing all this. What do you make of it? I mean, they tried to, I mean, stop Milo from speaking.
Well, you know, Alex, I think the biggest thing is here is that they call it, you know, the tolerant left. But one thing I realized here is that, you know, they call it the tolerant left and that we're accepting to everybody. But one thing that we would all agree on and that I would argue is that, listen, if you are not a liberal, you're not accepted. Okay? You can be gay, you can be transgender, you can be black, you can be an immigrant, you can be Muslim, but if you do not talk, walk, think, and believe the way they do, you're an outcast. You're an outcast. You're homophobic and Islamophobic and a sexist and a racist.
Oh yeah, I had family call me yesterday and go, they're saying you're a white supremacist on NPR. Is it true? Because they still think news. I'm like, yeah, you ever heard me say something like that? Again, but it shows how desperate they are. Great point. Go ahead. And then Milo pop in whenever.
Yeah, and I think too with the Lamont Hill on CNN, you know, calling, you know, these mediocre Negroes, you know, going to, you know, the White House to meet with Donald Trump and saying, you know, President Donald Trump, you know, saying that, listen, expressing extreme interest in helping solve the race relations.
And by the way, he means to try to bring, you could almost say it's real affirmative action, factories and jobs in. He means it.
He does. And it's just sad because my question is if, you know, Ben Carson and you know, if Ben Carson and some of the other prominent African-American figures in the community, if they don't represent the African-American people, then what does? And who's to say that Lamont Hill represents the African-American community. I mean, I honestly think Lamont Hill, I think he should be ashamed of himself. I mean, for me, in my book...
It's so bullying. I wouldn't imagine saying, you're gay, you're white, you're black, you're mixed, you're whatever. You're going to do what I say. That is so cultic, Milo. Great point well, that he's making.
It's the worst kind of racism, assuming that all black people have to think the same. It's the worst kind of sexism, assuming that all women are going to fall in line and think the same. And, you know, for Mark Lamont Hill to say it's only mediocre Negroes going to the White House, well, Kanye went to the White House. Does he think he's a mediocre Negro? Because I certainly don't.
Who's the mediocre one here?
Right. I mean, it's like, you know, getting your identity stripped away from you. You know, they say, I'm not gay now. They say Peter Thiel is not gay. They say, you know, you don't deserve to be a member of the LGBT community. They said that about me and Peter Thiel. And they've said it to us because we have the wrong opinions, because we believe the wrong things. We actually have our gay identity stripped away from us. It's like, you know, and this is sort of an admission. It's really telling. It's a very important point. They know that this stuff about, you know, patriarchy, white supremacy is garbage. And the reason you know they know is that when you step out of your ideological box, when you are a gay person who dares to be conservative, for instance, they try to take the gay bit away from you because they know that it gives you special privileges. They know that being a gay in public life, you can say things other people can't say. And this explodes the entire concept of privilege because it demonstrates that actually, if you're a straight white male, you are the least free in public life. You are the least free to express yourself.
Sure. Why do you think, this was obviously persecution before, not as much as they say, but it went on. Why then would they then become what they claim they were fighting? It's really, and then like worse than what they were fighting, because it's so vitriolic. It's so aggressive. It wants full control. I mean, normally a bunch of KKK guys just want their trailers and to hang around, act like lords over their little area, you know, some little, crap hole. Instead, they want to rule everything, Milo.
It's revenge. It's very simple. It's revenge. And a lot of these movements, and some people don't like it when I say this, but I think it's perfectly true. And Black Lives Matter is an example. Is a lot of these movements are run by very angry women. And those women often have had very bad relationships with men.
Milo, I'm going to apologize to you. And I mean this because I remember seeing you like 2 years ago going a bunch of ugly, fat, crazy women run this. And I was like, because I hadn't been out at many demonstrations in years. I was so busy. I hadn't seen the new wave. I've been out now the last 6 months. It's all a bunch. And I'm not being mean to white people. But it's true. It's like
angry white lesbians. It's angry white lesbians. It really is.
So what's going on with the fat, ugly, unattractive? I'm all for lesbians. Just they need to be lipstick lesbians. But seriously, what is going on with ugly lesbians pissed at everybody, stomping around, screaming, effing white male, and then there's all these weird, a few minorities behind them, bowing like they're the god. What the hell cult is this? So, Milo, explain it to me, because you exposed it first. What is going on?
I did see this first, and everybody made fun out of me for this, but I have been proven right, I have to say. It's all angry white lesbians. It's the same in gender studies departments at universities. You know, Black Lives Matter, a lot of, I mean, they're not.
No, I'm going to stop you. Guys, go to my Facebook. It's got millions of views. It's Alex Jones at Social at Women's March DC. I sat there for an hour as they screamed, F you, white male, F you, putting burkas on. It was all old white women, 90%. So you're right. Well, what's going on?
Well, I think that we have told women so many lies for so long. We have really done a disservice to one half of the population. Look, men are strong and intrepid and competitive, and they tend to overcome things. And men who are still single in their 30s, you know, they play sports, they play video games, they retreat into pornography, their own friendships, whatever. They kind of do okay. Women in their 30s who are single don't do as well. And because we've been lying to women through the tenets of feminism.
That's right. Men do well in solitary. Women don't.
Women really don't. And there's nothing better or worse about that. It's just that the sexes are different. They seek fulfillment in different ways. They're wired slightly differently. And women don't deal as well when they're, you know, in their 30s and they're still alone. And feminism has done this. You know, after the Second World War, with the increased participation in the workforce of women, women started to get more miserable. Every single survey taken of female happiness since the Second World War shows women getting progressively more unhappy with every single decade that passes. Now, that cannot be unconnected to the changing role of women in society, cannot be unconnected to...
Women running a household... And with a bunch of kids are happier than a pig, and you know what? Outside of that, they are totally freaked out.
I think everyone knows that. But feminism for 30 years has said there's something wrong with that. Like, you're buying into heteropatriarchal institutions, and you should be a strong, powerful, independent woman with a career of your own, and you can do the baby thing later. Well, you can't. You can't. And telling women that you can have it all has been awful for everyone, but especially awful for women.
And let's be clear. There are some women that are more alpha than alpha males who are great at business and life and everything. And those women that want that, that's great. The point is, don't force it on women.
Exactly.
Just like I'm like, I don't care if you're gay or straight. Don't force any of it. Just let people be free.
Why tell women, you know, why make women, and I think it's the majority of women, who want to have babies, who want to have a husband, who want to stay home. I think it's probably over 50% of women. Why tell those women there's something wrong with them? Why send messages to young women?
And that's what Gloria Steinem and the CIA did.
Exactly. You know, Gloria Steinem definitely did that. And, you know, and modern feminism now has taken on this really vindictive, mean, spiteful, unpleasant, lesbianic kind of like man-hating air, kill all, you know, white men.
No, I told the story when you were on Monday. I've been out with friends that have, you know, good-looking wives or whatever. And you're out. Literally, lesbians come up and try to take your women away from you. But the thing is, they're not ready to get punched in the teeth, though. It's like they're pretending to be men, but they're not.
Well, it's the cry bully thing, you know, like all feminism, they will throw bombs or be obnoxious or aggressive or behave inappropriately. And then the moment you respond, even 5% in the direction, you know, in their direction, they immediately turn around and play the victim and play the woman card. You know, it's like, oh, you are shouting at a woman. You are being physically intimidating to a woman. Yeah, because you were up in my face telling me, you know, that you want to kill all straight white men. What kind of what? How did you expect me to respond? This is another reason they hate me so much. I'm gay. I'll just turn around and say, honey, I will slap you.
Look at the way.
Well, you're a big guy, too, so they don't want that.
And look at the way, you know, look at the way Hillary Clinton, you know, look at the way Hillary Clinton ran her campaign. You know, the left is talking about Donald Trump ran this very, very divisive campaign. But look at the way Hillary Clinton, and Hillary Clinton is, she is exactly like a lot of other politicians do that are on the left. Victimize everybody. The gays, your victim. Transgenders, your victim. Blacks, your victim. And what that does is everybody has a victim mentality. So, and look at the way Hillary Clinton ran her campaign. It was, everybody was a victim. The gays are victims. The Muslims are victims.
And let's expand on that. She said, vote for me just because I'm a woman. Wasn't it women that actually elected Trump? At the end of the day, the demographics, they got that this was condescending. Milo?
Women came out to vote for Trump.
They did. Huge numbers.
They really came out to vote for Trump. And so, by the way, did you know, more millennials than anyone imagined. Why?
And by the way, an alpha male, a real alpha male, not a fake alpha male, who wants to pimp women. A real alpha male wants to do one thing, deliver to women. Milo, sorry, go ahead.
No, he wants to. And also men want to protect women. They want to, you know, they want women to be cherished and loved and treasured. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. And modern feminism says that's in some way demeaning. Of course, only a belief system as twisted and counterfactual logical as feminism.
Every species protects from whales to fish. When the woman's having babies, you better protect them. Every species protects the women. Because they're the magic creature that's producing the new people.
I know, it's odd. Only a system as bonkers as feminism could say that wanting to protect and provide for women was in some way demeaning. Like, that's the... only you know, modern feminism could come up with this. And the particular atmosphere, the thing I don't like about it, as somebody who is interested in free speech and free expression, is the chilling effect on fact, reason, debate, and logic of, you know, the atmosphere that's been created around around men's issues, the atmosphere that's been created around gender issues in general, where only women are allowed to talk about anything that has to do with sexism. And if anything negatively affects a man, oh, well, you had it good for 2,000 years. You know, and in particular... the language that's used about men in the public square and the sorts of discussions.
It's all very demeaning. It's all like, oh, like men didn't die by the millions in wars. Then they act like it's men that did the wars. It's the species. And the fact is, men are like the warrior ant of the women. The whole species is women. You study biology, you realize what a whole fraud the whole thing is.
Do you remember that Hillary quote where she said that war affects women and women and children disproportionately because they're the ones that lose their husbands?
and just to piggyback off of what you were saying there, Milo, I was down there. I had the honor, I guess you would say, I had the opportunity to be at, I was at the Women's March, but I was also at the March for Life. And it's a stark contrast. I mean, I was down there at the Women's March, and I know I'm a man, and who am I to say this, but I did not feel empowered. When I left there, I went back to the hotel. I took 3 showers with bleach and steel wool. I mean, it was absolutely ridiculous. I did not feel empowered. And it was a bunch of lesbian, just a lot of angry women. And so, And I look on the on the contrast, on the flip side, with the Women's March, you know, with the March for Life. These women were actually women that were military. They had families. They had businesses.
They were powerful.
And I'm like, wow, this is empowering.
They were powerful.
That's powerful.
Take the Trump inauguration. Whether you were white or black, the people were beaming. They were loving. Milo, you want to comment, give your perspective?
I mean, you've been to a Trump rally like I have. And
phenomenal.
How the media reports on Trump rallies.
Phenomenal.
Happy, enthusiastic, everyone's smiling, everyone's singing, everyone's having a good time. And the only people who are miserable at Trump rallies are the press in the pen at the back. And Trump is saying these people are slimy and losers and all the rest of it. And they are. And they deserve it.
That's another issue. You're a super successful, quote, gay man. They make that part of your life, your main definition. At Trump rallies, at Tea Parties, at Trump events, have you been made to feel unwelcome versus how the left makes you feel?
The only response is, oh my God, can I have your autograph? Can we take a selfie? I mean, and I'll tell you something else as well. I'll go even further, not just in Trump rallies, but, you know, I've been on a college tour for 9 months and I've been everywhere. I've been to Louisiana, I've been to Texas, I've been to, you know,
everywhere, man.
Exactly. I've been everywhere in America, you know, down to the South, you know, all the rest of it. The worst that anyone has ever said to me. And let me tell you, like, sometimes I get out of gas stations, like, practically in a skirt, you know, because I like to dress ridiculously and all the rest of it. I, you know, you can imagine me at a truck stop in Louisiana in drag, you know, getting off my tour bus that says dangerous faggot on the side. And you know what? The guy came up to me and said, don't agree with everything you do with your lifestyle, sir, but I like some of what you say and I'll pray for you. That's the worst thing that a conservative's ever said to me in America. Contrast that with the left, you know, the vindictive, mean, bullying lies from the media. The from the left, what do they do? Well, Don Lemon, black gay guy on CNN, allows somebody to propagate conspiracy theory about me having my own audience beaten up. Other people on the, you know, at CNN call me a white supremacist out of nowhere on the basis of no evidence, something absolutely
true. Me too.
And they do it to you too. That's the response from the left. That's the response of the left to a gay guy who's independent-minded and has, you know, some ideas
of his own. Exactly. So have they gone insane, or is there a method to their madness, Milo?
Well, they find me dangerous because, you know, look, nothing I say is particularly outrageous or outside the mainstream opinion. And here's the thing. None of the jokes I tell are either. If you think about the jokes that Amy Schumer or Sarah Silverman back in the old days before she contracted feminism, Margaret Cho... Think about the jokes, you know.
Contracted feminism.
Think about all of the jokes that these people used to tell about Jews, about blacks, about Mexicans. Wasn't it Sarah Silverman who said that she wants to have a non-Mexican boyfriend because she'd like her next sex to be consensual? Something like that. Funny jokes. I mean, funny, right? But I don't say anything.
I love redneck jokes. I mean, it's like all funny.
I don't say anything more dramatic or unpleasant about that. I just tell it about groups you're not supposed to laugh at anymore. And when you combine facts and studies with provocative language and jokes about groups that are supposedly protected by the left, you have a very dangerous combination. That's why I call my tour Dangerous Faggots, why my book is called Dangerous, because nobody can resist the truth wrapped in a good joke, and they cannot cope with somebody who is charismatic and funny and interesting telling jokes about their precious groups on the basis of facts, logic, studies, and reason.
All right, well, listen, whether it's this week or whatever, I'm ready to come out there and do the report. I love it. I appreciate your courage. And people, you know, we make jokes about this. This is dangerous, okay? So, Milo, be safe. Your book's number one on Amazon. It comes out in, the middle of March?
Yeah, a little while.
All right. Well, thank you for the time. Dangerous is the book. And, of course, people can find you at Milo. They can find you on Twitter, Facebook, everywhere. They're censoring them more and more, though. So realize this. Where's the best place to visit?
Well, finally, Google is returning results about me and not chocolate milk when you just put Milo in. So you can just put Milo in Google now. I'm winning the SEO wars. But yeah, Facebook, you can look for Milo. Just look for the verified tick, and that's the one that's me. And of course, Breitbart.com/Milo, where all the news buying about me
lives.
And
by the way, whether you love Milo or hate him, and I love him, if he loses his free speech battle, we all lose it together. They're coming after Drudge. They're coming after us. They're coming after everybody. We got to stand together for free speech. Milo, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me, Alex. Take care.
Well, that was a powerful hour interview. We're coming back in 5 more minutes, my friend. We're going to hand the baton over to Roger Stone, who's going to be taking over. Please support this broadcast. And again, whether you're super right-wing Christian, and I get that, it doesn't matter. It's all about free speech, folks. And we've got to come together for basic liberty. We've got to come together for basic prosperity. We've got to realize that globalists hate Milo because he's reaching out to people that have been under leftist bondage. Please get the new toothpaste, Super Blue, back in stock with the colloidal silver, the iodine, all of it, made by the biggest manufacturer of organic fluoride-free toothpaste in the country. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. That's how we find ourselves. We'll be back with the fourth hour. Stay with us. Big last 3 hours.